Now, one researcher did something a few years ago that what he decided to do was he was one of these people that thought, well, you know, kids just need to be free to roam and express themselves. And so he found a preschool that had a fence around it, and he decided it would probably be better for the kids if the fence was removed. So they took away the fence, and the kids went outside that first day. And because the fence was removed, he thought the kids would just be all over everywhere. But those little preschool kids with the fence removed, instead of going all over, they kind of clustered together right in the middle. And what he concluded was that children need boundaries. When the fence line was there, the kids went all the way to the edge of the fence. They felt safe and happy and secure. And let me just tell you something. As parents, it's your job and my job to put the fence boundaries up, right? To put the line in the sand. And it's our job to hold that line. And let me tell you something. How many of you know that kids are going to push and try to climb and try to get over those boundaries, but we've got to hold those, right? Amen. And that's our job as parents. And let me tell you, if we don't discipline our children, we don't really love them. I believe that. And if you have a mom or dad and you're in here today and they put boundaries in your life and they said, these are the rules of our house and I need to know where you are at all times and what you're going to be doing and who you're going to be doing it with. And yes, you will have your cell phone tracker on and all these different things. You need to thank your mother and dad today because they're doing their job. They're putting the boundaries down and they're saying, this is right and this is wrong. Amen. Now, I'll have you know that kids are probably going to push the boundaries, right? Yeah. Do I got any people who would at least kind of admit, at least to yourself, that when you were young, you pushed some boundaries yourself? Hello? We all have done it, right? But thank God for moms and dads who helped us to see that this is the right way. This is how you live. There's a verse in Deuteronomy 6 that I love. I've preached about it many times, and I'd like to read it to you out of the Living Bible today. It says this, it says, you must love him, speaking about God, with all your heart, soul, and mind. And you must think constantly about these commandments I'm giving you today. How many of you know we've got to know what the word says? We've got to put that into our hearts, into our lives. We've got to think about that. And it's our responsibility to teach it to our kids. The rest of the verse goes on to say, you must teach them to your children and talk about them when you're at home, out for a walk, and at bedtime, and first thing in the morning. Teach them to your children. That's a specific teaching. Then there's those moments when you're going throughout your day, right? Those spontaneous teaching, those interesting moments when we're constantly molding and making and showing what the Bible is telling us to do. And there's specific teachings. Let me give you just a couple of them. Today, we're going to teach our kids about spiritual things. Am I right? I'm so grateful for my own dad who, when I was just 5 years of age, recognized little Bobby needed to accept Jesus Christ, came over, led me in the sinner's prayer. Come on, it's our job to teach our kids about the Lord. And I think it's important that we bring them to Sunday school. Amen. Thank you. Amen. And we need to teach them about being able to select the right friends, especially as they get older in life. You know, sometimes kids, they don't want their mom and dad to know anything about who their friends are. Let me tell you something. It's our job to know, right? Because the scripture goes on to say, 1 Corinthians 15:33, that bad company corrupts good character. Am I right? And so thank God for mom and dads who teach their kids how to select friends that have positive peer pressure, that will encourage them in the right way, especially in junior high school and high school. We need to make certain that our kids are running with the right crowd. And then we need to teach them about self-control. One of the greatest teachings of Christianity is what I call delayed gratification, right? Live a holy life now, get rewarded in heaven. That's some serious delay, right? The world system is totally different. It says, take what you want now. There was a a study that was done. They call it the marshmallow test. They took a group of four-year-olds and they put them all in a room and they explained to these kids, they put a marshmallow in front of each one, said, don't eat it yet, and they explained to them, they said, you can eat this marshmallow now, or I'm going to leave the room in just a few minutes, I'm coming back. If you don't eat the marshmallow, I'm going to give you another marshmallow. Well, guess what happened? The guy left the room, but over half the kids ate their marshmallow immediately. Am I right? But there were some that understood delayed gratification, self-control. They didn't eat their marshmallow. And they actually, when the guy came back to the room, he gave those kids another marshmallow. They ate them together. And then what they did, they tracked these kids down through their life, as far as at least through high school went, and they discovered some things when they got into high school, that the ones that refused to eat the marshmallow, that understood self-control, guess what? They were more confident, they were more competent, more assertive, more reliable, and less likely when faced with difficulties to quit, and even make better scores on their SATs. So you say, the question becomes, well, how do I teach my kids self-control? The first thing you gotta do is you gotta model self-control, right? You gotta be able to control your own self, right? And you gotta teach your kids that waiting is not a bad thing.
That's right.
Can I have a cookie, Mom? No, after dinner you could have a cookie. That's not being mean, am I right? That's teaching kids delayed gratification. Or tell them after dinner you can have two cookies, right? And have you ever seen somebody in a Walmart or Target and the kid has got to have something? I mean, they've got to have it right now, and they're going on and on and on. Where did they learn that? Let me give you a great statement. This is awesome. If you have parents who shop till they drop, you'll have children that cry till you buy. Hello. If you have parents that have to have it right now, right? You don't teach your kids it's okay to wait. Now, yesterday was a kind of a neat day at our house, because for the last 21 years that we've owned the house, there's been this stove there. It's actually 32 years old. And I remember when we were remodeling our kitchen a few years ago, a lady came in. Jeff was doing the granite for us, and it was a customer, potential customer. And she looked at me and she said, oh, you need to get your wife a new stove. That's what she said. But you know what? We don't need a new stove, because that stove worked just fine. Hello? Yes, it looked like a 1950s model. But then we were fine with that, okay? We taught our kids it's okay to wait. Come on. Are there any people that think it's all right to wait? Amen. Absolutely. And how do we do it? Deuteronomy 6:7 says that we talk about them when you're at home, out for a walk at bedtime, or first thing in the morning. Amen. So the question becomes, how am I going to teach my kids to read God's word? Let me tell you how you do it. You model it by letting them see you read the word of God. Don't read the word in the bedroom where they can't see it. Bring it right out on the kitchen table. Come on. Do I have a witness in the house? How do you learn to serve? Let them see you serving God in church. How do you learn to teach them to pray? Let them hear you pray. Hello. Amen. Pray with a loud voice. Let them know that you believe in prayer. Come on. Things are caught and not taught. Amen. Malachi chapter 2, verse 15 tells us that another thing we can teach our kids is the importance of family and marriage. I love this scripture. It says this: you were united to your wife by the Lord. And God's wise plan, when you were married, the two of you became one person in his sight. And what does he want? Godly children from your union. Amen. He wants godly children, and God will help us to do that. Amen. And then D, in this little acrostic, is date your family. I like this one. Don't get me wrong. It could just be cooking some hot dogs and throwing a ball to the dog to go fetch, but those times are important. Amen. It's incredibly important. In my first church, I remember I was going on a vacation, And one of the guys that had been there in the church a long time, he came up to me and he said to me, "Man, I haven't had a vacation in 25 years. Wasn't quite as skilled maybe pastoring as I am now. I just said, "You know what, man, I feel so sorry for your family." Actually, I think it was a good response. "If you haven't had a vacation in 25 years, we're going to pray for your boss right now, because your family needs to go on a vacation. Your wife needs a little bit of time." Dude, I just put old Gary, put my hand on Gary's shoulder and prayed for him. He was absolutely shocked how I did that. But let me just tell you something. We need to be with our families. Ecclesiastes tells us this: "So I recommend having fun, because there's nothing better for people to do in this world than to eat and drink and enjoy life. That way we can experience some happiness along with all the work God gives them to do." Right? Amen. We need to be willing to date our family, be together, and date your wife, date your husband as well, kind of as a set point. And maybe you think, "Well, you know, I've got these kids and I don't know how all that's going to work." Let me just reframe this for you. You might have little Jessica. She might be your precious little jewel. And she's your first and only child. And you've walked with her for 3 long years and never left her with anybody. Let me just reframe this for you today. She needs a break from you. Hello? And if she could talk and tell you, she would tell you, "Why don't you go to Starbucks for a while? Go down to the beach. Go to a movie. Have some fun. Leave me with somebody else so I can get a little bit better socialized. Hello? And when you come back, maybe you'll be a little bit more relaxed and be a better parent." Come on, that's good preaching this morning. Amen? I'm just telling you, it's okay. It's okay to date your family. And then we've got to encourage our kids. Encourage our kids. You know, life can be discouraging. And it's a parent's job to bring hope and courage and confidence in them, to bring life into them and hope into their life. It's so important. Hebrews 10:24 is powerful. It says this: "Think of ways to encourage one another to outbursts of love and good deeds."